Welcome to worship. Wherever you are watching today, I hope you will experience in this service the meaning and purpose and hope of new life in Christ. Meanwhile, I have some good news to share. The session has voted to reopen to in-person worship here in our sanctuary starting on Sunday, March 6th at our usual time of 10 a.m. We will also continue to live stream our service so that people can watch from home if they feel more comfortable doing that. But we will be starting March 6th meeting here in our sanctuary. More details about this will be coming next week. Now let's continue with our gathering prayer.
Please join me in prayer. Lord God, we are grateful to you this morning for giving us this opportunity to connect with one another, to worship together, and to share a unified moment with you in this sacred space. We rejoice in the chance to grow in fellowship and to deepen our bonds with one another and with you. May you inhabit this space with rejuvenation, hope, and respite this morning. Now please join me in saying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Today, for celebrating with children, we're going to play a game called What's Their Job Now? We can put that on the screen. I'm going to show you some pictures of children, and I want you to guess what their job is now as adults. Okay? What's their job now? Here's the first one. This boy's named Keith. What job do you think he has now? Well, Keith is now a teacher. Here's the next one. This boy is named Martin. What job do you think he has now? Well, he still enjoys riding a bicycle, but his job is working for a trucking company. Now, here's another one. This girl is named Sabrina. What job do you think she has now? Sabrina is now a Presbyterian minister. One more. This is Mary. What job do you think Mary has now? Well, actually, we don't know because Mary was just born. Last week, this is my new little granddaughter. But whatever job she has, her job, like all the other children we've seen, her job is to become the person God wants her to be. That's the most important job of all of these children, to become the person God wants them to be. And you know, that's your job too. Let's pray. Lord God, thank you for creating us and giving us life. Help us all, at whatever stage of life we are in, to keep growing as the people you want us to be, living in the world you want us to have, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Because the Lord is my shepherd, I have everything that I need. He lets me rest in meadows green and leads me beside the quiet stream. He keeps on giving life to me and helps me do what others in the most. Even when walking through the dark valley of death, I will never be afraid, for He is close beside me, guarding, guiding all the way. His special guest, with blessings overflowing, His goodness and unfailing kindness shall be with me all of my life, and afterward I will live with Him forever, forever. Because the Lord is my shepherd, I have everything that I need. Forever, forever, it is home.
Now I invite you to join me in our prayer of confession, the words of which are printed on the screen. Please pray with me. Lord, you alone know how often we have sinned against you in wandering from your ways, wasting your gifts, and forgetting your love. Forgive us and bring us back into your arms, helping us grow as the people you want us to be, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our words of forgiveness today come from Romans chapter 6, verse 4, where the Apostle Paul says, "We have been buried with Christ by baptism into death, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life." Friends, believe that good news, that in Jesus Christ we are forgiven and invited into a new life with Him. The peace of Christ be with you all. Amen. Specific prayers for our joys and concerns today have been sent out during the week in our email prayer chain. Now I invite you to join together in prayers of the people. Let us pray. Lord, we begin this morning with a prayer for peace. peace in our world and peace in our country, peace in our cities and peace in our families, peace in our hearts and peace in our relationships. Lord, let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with us. We also pray for healing. Healing of bodies and minds, healing of confusion and alienation, healing of destructive attitudes and destructive actions. Lord, send your Holy Spirit on us to make us whole. And along with healing, we pray for wisdom and righteousness, courage and hope, steadfast love and faithfulness. Lord, equip each of us with the gifts we need to serve you and the fruits of the Spirit we need to live as the people you want us to be, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please join me in our prayer of dedication for our offering. Let us pray. Lord, we dedicate our gifts to you today, as well as dedicating ourselves to you, that you may work in all of us to help us grow as the people you want us to be, and be shaping our world into the place you want it to be. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Today, I'm joined in our scripture reading and in the sermon by Molly Meyer, our church's women's and small group ministry director. Let me begin by reading our first scripture lesson this morning. That is from Luke chapter 8, verses 1 through 3. Soon afterwards, Jesus went on through cities and villages, proclaiming and bringing the good news of the kingdom of God. The 12 were with him, as well as some women who had been cured of evil spirits and infirmities, Mary, called Magdalene, from whom 7 demons had gone out, and Joanna, the wife of Herod's steward, Chuza, and Susanna, and many others who provided for them out of their resources. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The second scripture reading is from Luke 10:38 through 42. Now as they went on their way, he entered a certain village where a woman named Martha welcomed him into her home. She had a sister named Mary who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to what he was saying. But Martha was distracted by her many tasks, so she came to him and asked, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to do all the work by myself? Tell her then to help me." But the Lord answered her, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and distracted by many things. There is need of only one thing. Mary has chosen the better part, which will not be taken from her." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Let's bow in prayer. Lord, open our ears to hear your word. Open our minds to understand it. Open our hearts to believe it. And open our lives to embody it. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I had always thought that Mary was the hero of the story that Molly just read for us, showing that women need not be relegated to the kitchen, that women can go to seminary, that women can study and teach theology, sitting at the feet of Jesus, listening to his word. And all that is true. But then I read an interpretation of this story from a recent best-selling book, The Lincoln Highway by Amor Towles. And I got a new perspective on it. One of the narrators in this book is a woman named Sally, who is always doing things for others in the story, but never seems really appreciated, especially by the principal character in the story, a young man named Emmett. Whenever Sally does something for Emmett, like bringing him dinner on the night in which he is released from prison, he thanks her, but then he says things like, "You didn't need to do that," in a way sort of belittling her gesture, which leads Sally to reflect on the story that Molly just read for us, the story of Mary and Martha. And I want to read now this little section of the book. This is Sally's commentary on that story from The Lincoln Highway by Amor Towles. At last week's Sunday service, Reverend Pike read a story from the Gospels in which Jesus and his disciples, having arrived in a village, are invited by a woman into her home. Having made them all comfortable, this woman, Martha, retreats into her kitchen to fix them something to eat. And all the while, she's cooking and generally seeing to everyone's needs by filling empty glasses and getting them second helpings, her sister Mary is sitting at Jesus' feet. Eventually, Martha has had enough, and she lets her feelings be known. "Lord," she says, "can't you see that my idler of a sister has left me to do all the work? Why don't you tell her to lend me a hand?" Or something to that effect. And Jesus, he replies, "Martha, you're troubled by too many things when only one thing is needful, and it is Mary who has chosen the better way." Well, I'm sorry, but if you ever needed proof that the Bible was written by a man, there you have it. From a man's point of view, the one thing that's needful is that you sit at his feet and listen to what he has to say, no matter how long it takes for him to say it or how often he's said it before. By his figuring, you have plenty of time for sitting and listening because a real meal, a meal is something that makes itself. The manna, it falls from heaven. And with a snap of the fingers, the water can be turned into wine. Any woman who's gone to the trouble of baking an apple pie can tell you that's how a man sees the world. That's when I realized that I probably am reading these stories through the eyes of a man, which is inevitable that I would see these stories from the perspective of a male. And that's why I've asked Molly to join in today's sermon. Molly is currently leading a women's Bible study in our church called In Her Eyes, A Female Perspective on the Bible, which would probably be helpful to any Bible story, but particularly this one. Welcome, Molly.
Thank you, Ken. It is valuable to look at Scripture through a different perspective and to see how much more we can learn from it when we see it from another point of view. And in this case, with the help of some feminist theologians, we can take a look at Mary and Martha in a new light that gives us a fuller understanding of the true freedom that comes with following Jesus. And this freedom is found in what Jesus referred to in this verse as the better part. And I bet if we went around right now and asked all of you virtually what the better part of the story would be, there would be some mixed answers. Some of you would say Kneeling at the feet of Jesus, like Mary, would be better, because we all crave to be as close to Jesus as we can. And I bet some of you would take the side of Martha, saying taking care of the tasks that need to be done is the better part, because through this, you can serve Jesus through works and hospitality. The better part doesn't side with Mary or Martha. Both women are doing exactly what they feel is right in the moment. And Jesus has nothing to say to either of them about their roles during his visit, until Martha has something to say about it to him. In verse 40, Martha goes to Jesus and asks, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to do all the work by myself? Tell her then to help me." Jesus answers her, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and distracted by many things, but there is need of only one thing. Mary has chosen the better part, which will not be taken away from her." Up until that point, Jesus had expressed no issue with Martha about her being distracted by many things, because up until that point, Martha wasn't distracted by anything that took her away from connecting and being close with him. She was not distracted when she was doing the work that needed to be done. She was not distracted when she chose not to sit at Jesus' feet like her sister. The distraction for Martha was her agitation. She was agitated with Mary because she was not helping with tasks that needed to be completed. She was agitated that there is so much that needs to be done, and currently only one person to complete any of it. And this agitation guides her to push Mary into helping her instead of sitting with Jesus. Mary is not showing agitation in this story. She is at peace with the choices she has made. She chose to sit at Jesus' feet. She chose to connect with him through conversation. And she chose to prioritize time with him face to face over completing her tasks on time, even if it risked putting her in a time crunch later to get it done. And she chose these things because she knew that the Lord gave her the freedom to worship him and learn from him in whatever way she was called to. This is the better part, our freedom to be with God in our own ways, by our own means, through our own choices.
Molly, I appreciate those insights, how Mary and Martha don't need to be pitted against each other. And I think I can see that applying to men as well as women, because men are also sometimes caught up in tasks rather than listening to Jesus. And the tasks are truly important. I'm not sure our church would be able to reopen if it were not for the slackers, that group of men and women who take care of our building and grounds. And the slackers have done so much work over the last 2 years to help our church be a better place in which to gather, even during even with COVID. In installing exhaust fans that improve our circulation, putting in overhead fans which contain air purifiers, adding a retractable awning to our courtyard, and along with propane space heaters that allow us to have coffee hour outside without masks and still be dry and relatively warm. Many men are like Martha. They are doers rather than listeners, talkers rather than those who just would sit at the feet of Jesus. But our church can appreciate both doers and listeners, both preachers and slackers, each following Jesus in the way that God has gifted us and led us. And I wonder if that isn't illustrated in our first scripture reading. Molly?
It is. In this story, we get to learn a little bit more about Jesus and how he carried out his ministry and the women who aided him along the way. And It appears there are a number of women who are with him, but three are named: Mary Magdalene, Joanna, and Susanna. These three women chose to give their time, their talents, and their energies to Jesus and his ministry. And as the scripture says, they provided out of their resources. We don't know what these resources are. The possibilities are endless. The important thing to recognize is that all of the women following Jesus were doing so by their own choice. They exercised their freedom to choose, to help with his ministry, and they chose to do so individually through each of their own personal unique resources. They were experiencing the better part. And I bet all of us here this morning can think of women in our own lives, perhaps even ourselves, who embrace the freedom to truly follow Christ in the way that we individually feel called.
And I think we saw an interesting example of this last year. One of our guest preachers last year by video was my niece, Kari Olson. Kari began her career in the food industry, working as a sous chef at a restaurant in Pullman, Washington. She then became the head of food service for Holden Village, a Lutheran retreat center on Lake Chelan. In a sense, then, Kari combined the serving of food with listening to Jesus at a retreat center. Then she took it a step further. She went to seminary and was trained in listening to Jesus and sharing Jesus' word. But then she was also ordained as a deacon in the Evangelical Lutheran Church of America, set apart for specific service as a deacon. And now Kari leads a food truck ministry in the St. Paul area, which takes food into communities of need on a pay-as-you-can basis, serving not only food, but the gospel at the same time. Which, Molly, I wonder if that's not an example of Mary and Martha combined.
I would say that it is. And I would like to dedicate a little time this morning to another story that's shows a woman who really embodies the characteristics of Mary and Martha at the same time. So in the evenings, I work at a restaurant as a server in Lakewood, right by the base. About once a week or so, a woman comes in by herself for dinner. She stays for hours, and her table is usually covered in papers, and she's speedily typing on her work laptop or maybe taking a business call. At first glance, it looks like she is fully immersed in her own very impressive professional bubble. And I love it when I get to be her server for two reasons. First, it's really inspiring to be able to connect with a woman who is so ambitious, so motivated, and so powerful in her job field. Her work ethic is something I greatly admire, and I've actually joked with her that I want to be like her when I grow up. But the second reason I love being her server is because of what she eventually slips into my hand as I walk by, her credit card. The first time she did it, it was a little alarming. Her food hadn't even come out yet, so I was wondering why she was trying to give me money. But she quickly explained that part of the reason she likes coming to the restaurant is because she often observes young families coming in who don't have a lot of money, but really need a night out to reconnect with one another and to just unwind. She said that when she was younger, she would often come to this restaurant with her partner, scrounging up whatever change they had so that they could go out, because it brought them both so much peace and rejuvenation to their spirits. So while she's there now, elbows deep in her paperwork, she is also watching to see who comes in. And when she sees a young family enter, she will secretly pay for their meal and slip me the credit card to do so. She bashfully jokes that while it isn't much, it is a little ministry effort that she likes to do, because she knows from experience the impact that it can make. She never likes to be recognized for doing this, so I have to be a little sneaky. All she wants is to be able to give others a moment to enjoy themselves, to put aside their distractions for a little while. And her effort to help others does not hinder her ability to make great professional strides. She knows that Christ gave her the freedom to choose how she might aid his ministry and with what resources that she has. And she chooses to embrace the better part in a hole-in-the-wall Italian restaurant in Lakewood, while also staying on schedule with her work calls at the same time. It would be a real shame if she felt like she didn't have the freedom to choose one or the other or both. But Jesus has set her free. He has set us free, all women, men, all people, to serve in all the ways to which we might be called. And we rejoice in that today. Amen.
Dwell in darkness.
And now, to the one who is able to do far more abundantly than all that you ask or think, to God be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus now and forevermore. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen.